enjoy the fellowship we will be having tonight. No, let everybody be proactive. Let everybody be expectant and joyful.
Yes.
Amen, amen. Okay, right now, YouTube na.
Yes. Relied. Ina.
Ah, sige, kaway-kaway tayo, everyone!
Hi!
Hello po!
Good evening!
Welcome to Life Hub!
Yes!
Bye.
Yay!
Ana, yun. Hello, mga kaibigan, pastors, kahabmates, at Facebook friends, YouTube friends sa ating live. Ayun.
Yes.
Good evening po and good welcome evening to Life Hub University. Yes, I am Micah, one of your hosts tonight. Katulad ko po, siguradong handa and expectant na din kayo, di ba? So our episode for tonight has something to do not just with our future love life and family, but with our present fulfilled life. Excited po ba kayo doon?
Yes.
Yes, you heard it right, mga friends. So dito po sa Life Hub, the Lord is gathering the youth and those with the same heart for the youth from different groups and churches with the goal of working together.
Amen.
Edifying po and one another regardless of how we label ourselves. Just one, we are here because we are hungry for God's move upon the youth. Are you hungry din po ba?
Yes.
Yes.
We don't want to miss this season of equipping. So while others have burned their hours watching movies that satisfy the flesh, others being overwhelmed by fear and idleness, we choose to be productive and intentional for growth and to pursue purity now. Now, na po, now, yes. So we are here for another intentional evening. Yeah. Intentional in our pursuit of purity.
Yes.
Woo-hoo. Yes.
So if you join, so you will receive the keys to having a more colorful love life. Ayun, love life. So for tonight, after the long wait, huh, so we bring you tonight's episode.
Patiently waiting. Again, mapagpalang gabi po. I encourage us all na maging teachable, maging magpa-equip at matutong mag-submit. Kaya sagarin na natin ang pag-attend dito sa Life Hub University. Amen po ba?
Yes.
And wag nang magtangkang umabsent. By the way, ako si Reggie, single and patiently waiting. Hindi nagmamadelay at patuloy na lumalaban sa panalangin.
Wow.
Siyempre, binabati ko lahat ng nandito ngayon sa Zoom. Na? Si Pastor Noemi.
Yes.
Si Pastor George.
Woo-hoo.
Even sis Ate Alpha, Ate Mick, Doc Samsi.
Hello,
Sister Desiree. Hello. Yes. Pastor Derek. Pastor Shara, hello. And Ate Elaine, hello. Hello po. Sister Mana, Ate Kuya Carlo, Ate June, Brother Van, Rochelle, Riza, and
hi. Hello.
Pastor Frederick, and all of you po na nandito nanonood niyan dito sa Zoom. And to all fathers who are present, hello po, kaway-kaway po dyan sa mga tatay na nanunood ngayon para gabayan tayo, no? Sa mga hubmates din nating present and patiently tuning in sa YouTube Live or saan na kayo ngayon, muli, welcome to Life Hub University. But before we continue, let's hear from our good friends here sa Zoom who are eager to receive and warm our evening with their greetings.
Wow.
Welcome muna natin ang ating mga hubmates from different campuses. First, Doc Sam, see.
Sound check. Can you hear me? All right. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, friends, our hubmates all around the world. Ayan. I am Sam C, all the way from Life Hub University's North Luzon Campus. Ayan. Naririnig nyo ba yon?
Yes!
Wait, pakinggan natin mabuti. Kalimutan ko pala sabihin, I'm the future doctor of Life Hub University. Yan. Pero narinig niyo ba yun? Narinig. Ayan.
Yes.
Marami parang kinakabahan.
Parang iba daw yung tinitibok ng puso mo. Parang hindi ata galing kay Lord yan. Naku!
Oh no!
Heart check! Kaya naman, stay tuned in! Listen and... Alam mo, free ang diagnosis dito sa Life Hub University.
Oh, check.
Ah, kaya naman, Hubmate, come on and listen and have your heart be checked. And, ayan, let's listen to the word that will be shared tonight. Ayan.
Yes.
Ako, I'm mula sa North. Kaya naman, tatawagin natin ang ating Hubmate na galing pa sa South ng Philippines to greet us tonight. So, let's welcome Kuya George.
Hello mga ka-hubmates. I'm George from Davao Campus. And well, thank you by the way, Samsi, for introducing. And I'm very glad na naka-tune in ako. I mean, nakasali na ako from Facebook Live ngayon. Nandito na ako mismo sa Zoom and I'm very happy for that. And natutunan ko na ang pag-ibig ay hindi parang phone, ano, yung katulad sa kanta ni Yeng na pag naluma na ay pamigay na lang. Ang pag-ibig hindi rin parang damit. Pag bagong uso, papalitan. Yun. So minsan we miss the reality that waiting is part of the process in finding the one that God has prepared for us. From the point of being single to married, we have the waiting season. Yung panahon kung saan akala natin we are waiting for God to give us the answer. But the truth is, God is waiting for us. Yes, God is waiting for us to trust Him. And hindi ang ating feelings o kaya level of compatibility. But God is waiting for us na maniwala at magtiwala that He is in control even in the area of our relationship, maski sa usapang pag-ibig. And lastly, the Lord is still great kung di man kayo para sa isa't isa. And He will be always faithful and He will give us blessing. And then we really need to wait sa ngalan ng pag-ibig. This is George from Davao. Peace out.
Yeah! Okay. Yeah, check. Can you say hi po?
Hi.
Check po. Hi. So, hello everyone. Hello Pia George. Welcome everyone.
Welcome.
Hi po. I am Van. College student of this University of the Cordilleras and a musician ng Lord. Alam po maraming musician dito. Hello po sa inyo. Hello to the pastors and to the members. And I would like to say, be with everyone here at Life Hub. Thank you for inviting our church. Lahat kami dito. We are blessed to have you guys na makapag-fellowship with. And ayon sa breaking news this afternoon, postponed ang opening ng klase, kaya make the best out of your time. Simuli dito sa Life Hub. Dahil hindi lang dapat tayo uno sa statistics or sa sciences, but more importantly, sa ating life skills na matututunan natin dito sa Life Hub. Kaya nga po, Life Hub, I believe in yung rason. And as I continue to enjoy yung iba't ibang usapan dito sa Life Hub, I realize that to patiently wait means having an attitude of trust and faith. Hindi ito panahon upang mag-trial and error sa ating relationship, but a season for you to prepare and draw closer to God. At paalala,
amen.
Anyone can say I love you, but not everyone can stay and prove it's true. Mag-connect sa prayer and hear the Lord say, while you are waiting, I am working. And while you are trusting, I am moving. Thank you. My name is Van. Welcome to everyone and hi.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Samsi, George.
Namay namin yan.
Van, yes. Thank you so much. Man, matindi. Umpisa pa lang, di ba? At mapapa-patiently waiting ka talaga. So, good evening, everyone. I am Alpha, excited, but at the same time, I'm also patiently and enjoying my waiting season. Yes. Kung last Friday, napasana all tayo sa mga
nakahanap ng kanilang the one, at kung nasa stage ka pa ng finding the one, tandaan na hindi lang dapat ito hanapin. Ngunit dapat ipaglaban sa panalangin. Yes!
Laban!
At hintayin sapagkat there is a time for everything. Woohoo! Kung feeling mo,
yes.
Yes, kung feeling mo ikaw ay napag-iwanan na ng panahon. And if one of your question right now is, how about me, Lord? Patiently, we should be patiently.
How about them, waiting. Lord?
Ano na yan, Lord?
How about them?
Oh my God, amen. So,
amen.
Yes. God wants the best for each and every one of us. Amen?
Yes. Pero paano nga ba ang mag-wait patiently, mga kahabmate?
Tanong mo lang niya.
Paano nga ba? Yun. Mamaya. Pero syempre, aminado din tayo na minsan nakakabagot, nakakapagod, at nakakalungkot, plus nakakapangit ang maghintay because in our generation, we are used to having things in an instant, diba? Parang instant coffee or instant noodles. Kaya nga, nauso yung hanap-usap deal, diba? Kaya naman, hindi maiwasan na malabo pa din sa atin kung paano nga ba i-handle ang ating waiting season. So as we pursue our commitment of purity, the good news is, hihimayin natin ang usapang ito ngayong gabi. Kaya habaan nyo. Habaan natin ang patience, mga kahabmates.
Ayan. Ayan, that's right. No? God is preparing the best for you. Amen. And you to lead a victorious and a blessed marriage life Woo-hoo! In the future. Amen. Waiting Woo-hoo! Season is not a wasted season. That's true. It may be a time where you feel like you got nothing left and that there's nothing you can do. Mga time na pakiramdam mo, you have lost your strength to people, no? You've run out of hope and love. Pero hindi yan ang finale ng na gusto ng Lord para sa'yo, no? Huwag mawalan ng pag-asa. For tonight, aabangan natin what to do while waiting. Strategic talk and testimonies on how to trust God in the process.
Yes!
Again, we invite you to join us, share and tag your friends and family at this moment. Be inspired and encouraged with this video.
Yes!
I start praying to God. I said, Lord, if you are about to give my life to a partner, it will be a partner that will truly be in love with you. Is there a man who would really accept me from my past?
God showed me this vision about me walking in the aisle, and like your face was very clear. I was wearing a white gown, and from that moment, you were the one in front at the altar.
And my total shock that God would speak to me so clearly, and it was the most opportune time to pray about what I already felt God was saying to me, because God wanted to speak first, and God wanted to speak louder than us at first.
The moment I knew that it was Derek, God gave me this word in the book of Genesis chapter 28. And God Almighty bless thee and make fruitful and multiply, and you will be a multitude of many people, and give thee the blessings of Abraham, because you are a seed and may inherit the land to which it is strange to you.
I never noticed that God gives a perfect gift. And I realized that he wasn't saying you were perfect or I was perfect. He was saying, she is perfect for you.
The Lord is so good because he brought you into my life. You have accepted me. You just bring colors into my life.
You are my dream come true. You are the gift of grace that God has given me. you are the greatest gift God has given me. Today is the day that the Lord has made.
And from that moment, and I ask the Lord, Lord, is this really the man whom I'm going to marry? And God really hear it. And the Lord God talked to me through the passage in the book of Genesis chapter 28. And in this passage, God has reminded me about to wait is to trust.
Once again, thank you, Pastor Derek and Ate Sarah, for sharing that wonderful wedding video. Grabe naman talaga. Pag talagang si Lord yung sumulat ng love story natin, di ba?
Yes.
So, let's claim it for ourselves too. Amen?
Yes.
Amen.
Ingit tayo, no? Ingit tayo. Hindi po yan acting lang. Yes. It's a true love story written by God.
Yeah.
A story that testifies that the best love story is the one authored by God. Ayun. How about you, Hubmates? Are you excited for your love story? Yes. Are you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, sabi nga sa video, yes. No? To wait is to trust. Kaya hintay-hintay din, di ba?
Yes.
Last week, no? Last week, binalaan tayo na huwag papadala sa mga wave-wave lang hanggang sa heart react, no? Huwag pa-fall and huwag ma-fall, no? Kung nawawmali ka at nasawi ka man sa pag-ibig, you have to be wiser this time and trust God. Amen. And because He has made everything beautiful in His time.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, I agree. So kung hindi man ngayon, may tamang panahon.
Yes.
Kaya mga Hubmates, panahon na. Woo-hoo. This is the time for us to receive. Mm-hmm. Amen. It's a great pleasure to have a wonderful couple who are also parents to be. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Yes, congratulations. Yeah, so for joining us tonight, so despite their busy schedules, we thank them for making their time to share their heart and encourage us this evening.
Yes.
Amen. So first up, together with us is the president of History Makers Academy and founder of History Makers Society, both of which are designed to train, equip, and send out individuals to influence all spheres of society. So he conducts trainings and seminars internationally on a variety of topics, helping individuals to fulfill their highest potential.
Yes.
Amen. So, and of course, together with him is his other half,
woo-hoo!
A Proverbs 31 woman,
yeah!
Yes, an intercessor with the heart, pastor the youth,
woo-hoo!
Once brokenhearted, but waited and trusted in the Lord's perfect plan.
Amen.
A precious daughter who let God write her story. Both of them pursued purity and waited patiently, which makes them very qualified to share the word to us tonight. Amen. So, Hubmates, let's all welcome our family from FGTS WLI Philippines, Pastor Derek and Sarah Schneider.
Wow, that was so nice introduction. It
Makes
our heart like, wow, so nice.
Wow, and you edited that video so well. You made me look handsome. Wow. So nice. Greetings from us to you, especially Dr. Noemi and Pastor M and Alpha, Micah, everybody, the whole Life Hub University. I feel really honored. You know what?
Welcome.
You know what? One thing you need to know about how society works and how people work is that people generally don't want to choose the evil way. People choose what is trendy. They follow the trends. And you can actually make purity trendy. And what I was seeing tonight with you guys, I was saying to myself, as I was hearing the energy, seeing your faces, doing excitement, I thought, man, I would want to be part of this group. If I didn't know Jesus, if I was say, wow, purity is the trend. I would want to be part of this group. Your greatest challenge is going to be getting, you know, this group out there to get people aware of who you are, because there is power on this broadcast between all of you. Hear me clearly. Amen. Give me a thumbs up if you can hear me clearly.
Amen. Yeah.
Amen.
So, you know what? I don't want to take too much of your time tonight, but I want to be a blessing to you. We want to be a blessing to you. You know a bit about our story, and I just want to say it's such an honor to speak with you tonight. I hope that you'll take some notes, because I want to give you a little bit on the subject of patience is for a season, not a moment. Patience is for a season. I see heads nodding like, oh yeah. Patience is a season, not a moment. Most of us would like to think that we are patient people and we're patiently waiting, but patience is proven over a period of time. And yes. God put you to the test. God will put this to the test with you. Patience is meant for, you know, process and season, not for moments. You don't need patience for a quick moment. In fact, the things that are fast, as I heard somebody say on here already, we want the kind of fast food culture type thing. You know, a quick sexual immorality is fast. It's a moment and it's over, and there can be lifelong consequences. But if you have patience, God can give you something that's of value and beauty forever. He can give you the desires of your heart. Now, you don't have to turn there, but definitely write down some of these scriptures I'm going to give to you tonight. The first one, I'm sure you know it very well, but it's Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 3. Once again, that's Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 3. We quote it a lot, and it's the first scripture I want to give you tonight. It says, for the vision, how many have a vision for your marriage? Do you have a vision? If you don't, you need to get one. You need to give God something. Amen. You need to inject faith into your vision. Bring your vision and faith into agreement, and you give God something to bring along your path. Amen? For the vision is yet for the appointed time. Let everyone say appointed time.
Appointed time.
You already
pointed time.
He said here tonight that, you know, he makes all things beautiful in its time. You know, the appointed time comes on the other side of patience. The appointed time arrives on the other side of patience. It says it hastens toward the goal and it will not fail. Sometimes it feels like we're not moving forward. Sometimes I know definitely, think of it, I was 38 years old and speaking at conferences all over the world. And I just gave up. I just said, Lord, I'm meeting all kinds of people. I can't seem to feel that love for one of them. And what's going on? Maybe I'm never going to marry, you know? And I didn't realize that God was processing me. He was doing some things along the way. I didn't know I was hastening towards the goal. I didn't know the goal was approaching, and I definitely didn't think the goal would be in Philippines. But it was out of the
promised land.
Out of the Philippines came the goal. Though it tarries, or though it's delayed, it's never really delayed, but it will feel like it's delayed. If it doesn't check this out. If it doesn't feel like delay, you won't have to have patience. If it doesn't feel like it's delayed, you won't have to have patience. So though it delays, wait for it. The wait part is important. That's what this is all about. For it will certainly come, it will not delay. I want to challenge you tonight, from this moment on, to put genuine, sincere faith in God that he has someone for you. I'm telling you, it's harder than it sounds. You've got to really genuinely say, God, I believe with all my heart, you have the right person for me. Because look, do we know what we need? I didn't even know what I needed for dinner tonight, let alone do I know what I need 10 years from now. Do we really know what we need? Guess who knows who we need? God knows. Okay, so now when we catch the context of Habakkuk chapter 2, we're talking about something that feels like it's delayed, and God is reassuring you that it's coming. Here's what you don't want to do. Do not awaken love until it's time. There's a reason. I'm getting some amens on that one. Do not awaken love until it.
Amen.
Now, when I say that, most of you might think in your minds, oh, it's because you might sin. Don't awaken love until it's time because you might sin. Yes, that's a big reason not to awaken love until it's time. But there's another reason you shouldn't awaken love too soon. When love is awakened too soon, you can make your road a lot more difficult. You can even destroy the thing God is trying to bless you with. But let me give you an even better reason to not awaken love until it's time. And here it is right here. The process of having to wait produces a great appreciation for when the promise arrives.
Amen.
I'm going to say that one more time. You think you got it, but really catch this. The process of having to wait and be patient through that process means not only will you be properly prepared, God will have done the character stuff. See, because if you awaken love too soon, you will go into a relationship for the purpose of what you can get from that person rather than what you can give to that person. Many of us have errors. Did you catch that? You go into that relationship, if you awaken it too soon, it's you're going to try to get something from that person rather than from the overflow of your life, be able to bless that person. But not only that, when you've got to go through the process and pay the price of patience, the level of appreciation, the level of glory. I mean, when you've carried that cross, man, when you have had to go through some stuff and that time comes, it is way better than anything else you have experienced, emotionally, physically, spiritually, and sexually. Let me tell you something, because we're all adults here and we've all learned about sex since we were very young, probably. When you wait, there's a level of anointing. There's a level of blessing. Remember, God created sex. He knew what he was doing. He knows how to bless you. There is a level of blessing when you wait that will knock your socks off. I hope you don't mind me saying that. I won't go too deep on that, but let me just say, sorry, my wife is just probably dying here, but listen, I'm not the only one that believe. I have friends in ministry who said, man, Derek, if you can wait, after marriage, it's something altogether different. The process of patience produces an excitement, an anticipation the delay to get there. Now, let me show you this in Song of Solomon. I'm going to prove this to you. You all know Song of Solomon. Read at your own discretion. But I want to unpackage a quick process here that's going to blow your mind, and I hope you'll write it down. But I'm going to read to you from Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verses 8 to 17. You can just write down the text. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verses 8 to 17. And I want you to catch the season. There's an emphasis here. It's a season that I'm going to be reading to you. There's a change of season. There's a process of a season. There's a process of patience that is producing a longing that will be greatly satisfied. Here it is. The voice of my beloved. Behold, he comes. Leaping over the mountains. I think I quoted that. I said, leaping on the airplane all the way to the Philippines. Behold, he comes, leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Behold, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, looking through the lattice. My beloved speaks and says to me, arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. For behold, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone, the flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in the land. So you're catching the seasonal thing, right? The fig tree ripens its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. And I'm going to catch the rest of it in a moment. Okay, now I want to give you the process of patience. Just, you can write that down, or let's make it this way. The process for the seasons of love. Verse 8 says, the voice of my beloved, behold, he comes. Leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. Number one, this is the season of pursuit. Notice that the man is pursuing here. And women, you are worthy to be pursued. You are worthy to be pursued. The man is initiating here. You hear his voice. Behold, he comes leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. There's a season for pursuing. Now, when I say a season for pursuing, that means, ladies, make him work for it. Like, take your time. This doesn't have to be so, just because he Facebook messaged you means nothing. Make him go through the season. That's the first step. The first step is the pursuit. Even God plays hard to get. Now, you don't have to be manipulative. But even the Lord will pull back. I see people laughing there. Even the Lord will pull back on giving himself to you. Why? He wants you to appreciate him, and he wants you to go through the process. Women, you are God's creation, and you are worthy of a man going through the process. Because if he won't go through the process of patience in the season of pursuit, he will quit on you pretty quick if you get married. The first stage, let him pursue you. Don't move fast. Let him prove his pursuit. That's number one, the season of pursuit. Now look at verse 9. I'll give you a minute to jot down some of those things I said there. The season of pursuit. And man, if he's bounding over the mountains and he's like a young stag, you know, come running to the church, jumping over the chairs. Don't let that scare you. That's how men are when they're pursuing someone. They're just, you know, all in. He should be bounding, not teasing and flirting. Verse 9. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Behold, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, looking through the lattice. Now, I know it would be pretty scary if there was some guy that liked you and he was staring in your windows. at nighttime. That would not be a good thing. But I want to show you a picture of what's taking place here. This verse 9, where it says he's behind our wall, gazing through the windows, looking through the lattice. This is the season of another test called the test of the Father's house. This is the test of the Father's house. And I'll tell you why. Song of Solomon was written this way to paint a picture of the process for a man to qualify to reach the woman. And the first stage was he's on the other side of the wall. And if you know the original language and what this was about, this was literally about a man who could not touch her, could not get too close to her, didn't have Facebook Messenger. All he could do was hope to catch a glimpse outside the family home. And the process by which he could reach her, because she was in the vineyard behind the house. So there was actually a process that the guy had to go through to get to the vineyard where she was. This was highly poetic and profound language. The man had to, the door to the family home had to be opened by the father. The man actually had to get the father's blessing. And to get to her in the backyard, he not only had to go through the wall, but he had to go through the house. He had to enter the front door of the family home and be allowed through the family home. Oh man. And then be allowed into the vineyard where the daughter was, where the bride was. This is powerful language for having to be approved by the father, having to be affirmed by the family, or at the very least, because you don't always have that. Maybe the dad's not around or something, but you have to be approved by God the Father. You have to go through the process of the family home. Maybe she doesn't have a family that cares about her. This is the process of going through the church family, getting the blessing of the pastors. You know, this is very, very powerful language. He's peering through the lattice and he's got to be let in by the Father. This is how it works in our lives. By now, men, you know, you're going to be really tested. And I had to go through this. I had to meet with Papa Son. And I had to come bounding over the mountains on an Air Canada flight. I flew here from wherever I was. I remember the very first night I was here and the door was open. I was so jet-lagged. I was tired. I wanted to make a good impression. And on the first night, it was like 9 o'clock. I had come from ministry. I was exhausted. There I was. The front door had been open, but I wasn't in the backyard yet. I wasn't in the vineyard. And they had questions for me. And we had discussion. And I remember they had to turn on every fan in the house because I was dripping with sweat. I was dripping with sweat. And ladies, this is how you're going to know if the guy is worthy of you, if the guy's going to pursue you for life. He's got to go through the process. And this requires patience. Men, it requires patience to go through this. Women, it requires patience to wait because you want to say yes quick. You want to give in quick. You know why? Because you're afraid. You're afraid you're going to be alone. You're looking for that man. Culture is rushing you towards that thing. Don't rush. And I have 1,000 reasons why not, but won't have time to give them tonight. All right, sure. Let's move on quickly to verse 10. So that was the season of the family home. Now verse 10 says, my beloved speaks. So now they're chatting on, they've got some chats going on. They're Zoom calling, they're on the phone. My beloved speaks to me and says, arise my love, my beautiful one, and come away. This is the season where the man makes his intentions clear. He opens up and says what his intentions are. Ladies, if he can't muster up the courage to tell you and anybody else, I don't know if I should go there tonight. I don't know. If he can't tell you what his intentions are, he's got 2 to 3 other ladies waiting in the wings. Because let me tell you the truth, when you love a woman, when you are pursuing a woman, you will make it known. A man will be like a lion when he is, I'm sorry, not using the word hunting, but when a man will become a lion when he is pursuing a woman. So be suspicious of a man that won't make his intentions clear. Be suspicious of that. Because when a man wants you, his inner motivator is just, and sometimes he won't even, I see some people in the Philippines, they post in a relationship, but they don't say with who. So you don't know. Each girl thinks, well, maybe it's me, or maybe it's me. All these old tricks. I come from the rap world. I know how it all works. Ladies, you deserve somebody to make his intentions clear to you and everybody else. He should be standing there like, yeah, heck yeah, I want you. I am speaking. My beloved speaks and says, arise, my darling, my beautiful one. That is like, come on, let's do this. It's the season of making intentions clear, verbally stating what your intentions are. I've counseled young people for a long time, and I always say to girls who ask me about this, I say, if he has not expressed his intentions, do not take him seriously. No matter how long the chat log is, no matter you stayed up talking for an hour, or he said this, or he did that, if he hasn't stated his intentions, don't let your heart go crazy. He's not serious. He's not serious. Don't give your heart away. If he winks at you, if he sends you hearts, you know, yeah, you bloop, 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 bloop. You've got to go away. If he sends you selfies, you know, don't buy into the hype. That man, if he's serious, he will verbally express his intentions. Man, I just want to see-law that for a moment, but let's keep going here. Verse 11, here's a powerful change of season. He's pursued her. So you've gone through the season of pursuit that needed patience. You've gone through the season of the family home where the family got to know you. You needed patience. Now you've gone through the season where there's been dialogue of here are my intentions. And the woman maybe says, here are my intentions, or here are my expectations. That required patience. God has spoken. They're sure. That's why they vocalized it. The shift and change of season took place. Verse 11, behold, the winter is past. The rain is over and gone. Behold, the winter is past. The rain is over and gone. This is the change of season. The season of nothing is over. The season of emptiness and void is over. It's a new season. The change of season, the season of nothing is over. Verse 12, the flowers appear on the earth. The time of singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. This is the season where the people around you are affirming the relationship. They're singing over it. The angels are singing. The two of you walk across the room and flowers are in bloom. The turtle doves are making noise. This is where it's just nothing but bliss and blessing, and you know, something has happened and your family recognizes it, your pastors recognize it. There's a good reason to be careful when the people closest to you don't give blessing. Now, there are exceptions to that, but in general, when people don't give blessing, chances are they see something you might not see, maybe because you went too fast. So that's the season of affirmation in verse 12. Now, verse 13, here's where it gets a little wild, and we'll wrap this up pretty quick here. Verse 13, the fig tree ripens its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth their fragrance. Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. This is getting deep now. O my dove, verse 14, in the cleft of the rock, meaning the hidden place. He hasn't quite seen her yet. Let me see your face. And some versions will say, let me see your form. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. This is the season where you finally have a certain level of appropriate emotional intimacy. It's the season of emotional intimacy. Now, let me give you a very firm warning. Emotional intimacy is designed by God to move you quickly into sexual intimacy. I'm going to say that again because that's loaded. Emotional intimacy is designed to take you quickly into sexual intimacy. That's why it's supposed to be beginning around the time of all these steps are in place and engagement has happened. It's supposed to be a season where you can hardly hold back and marriage needs to happen. And how is emotional intimacy born? Through a whole lot of talking, a whole lot of chatting, a whole lot of walking together, whatever it is that's done in the culture out here. Maybe you go eating some durian together or something. I don't know what you do out here, but let me tell you, the more time you spend with someone, the more you'll connect to them emotionally. This is how adultery happens, by the way. Adultery almost never begins with some wild, sexually charged encounter. Adultery begins with emotionally connecting with someone. These days, it begins with a text. It begins with a chat, because the chat world is vague enough and secretive enough that you actually can mix fantasy. Fantasy and the chat world go hand in hand. You're not really talking to the real person. You don't know. You could chat with somebody online for 2 years, and then when you get together with them in person, you find out you hate each other. You find out, what was I thinking? This person in real life is awful. Something about his smell turns me off. He's annoying, or she's picky. You just don't know. And that's literally how adultery happens, is it begins in the online world through an emotional connection that's not real, and it's emotions you didn't pay the price for. You're connected and that thing kicks in. Emotional intimacy is meant to lead quickly into sexual intimacy. That's why it's more the engagement season where you really are emotionally connecting with that person. I have two friends of mine and, you know, he was courting his now wife and he wanted to pray for her each evening on the phone. And she was like, oh, no way. You're not praying with me. You're not my husband. We start praying together. And you know what's going to happen? We're going to have this spiritual connection. I'm going to look at you as my savior and mentor. And I'm going to be deceived thinking that this spiritual connection is something romantic. And she said, we will not be praying together like that. Until engagement, until we've heard from God. Meaning she wouldn't allow intimate emotions to get entangled because emotions are deceiving. Emotions are deceptive. And let me tell you something. My mentor said this to me a long time ago, and I hope you'll catch it the right way, but even your spiritual encounter, the amount of people I've had sitting in my office who have had some spiritual sign, and it absolutely wasn't, and it didn't work out. My mentor said to me, Derek, even if an angel shows up and tells you this is the person you're to marry, you better get to know her practically over a period of time, because you won't be living with that angel. You're going to have to live with her for the rest of your life. So you better get to know her. There is a process to this thing. So emotional intimacy now in our story is leading quickly into marriage. Verse 15, catch the foxes for us, the little foxes that spoil the vineyards, for our vineyards are in blossom. This is a season I hope you don't have to go through, but it's legitimate, it's actual warfare that goes on when you're about to come into the promise. I had, when Sarah and I were at that stage, when we were in the engagement stage, she had ex guys contacting her out of the blue. I had ex-girlfriends appearing out of nowhere. Suddenly, you know, even when they didn't know we're about to get engaged, you know, they just appeared. Is this true?
Yes.
Like, I was sitting next to her and ring, and she showed me, because we have an open relationship, you know, and we couldn't piece together where these people were coming from. It was like there was some Satan that was trying to send the little foxes to spoil the vineyard. I made it. I pursued her over the mountains all the way to Southeast Asia. I pursued her through the Father's house. I had finally made it into the vineyard, and there's these dang little foxes running around trying to spoil things. Ladies and gentlemen, kick the foxes out. Get rid of the exes. Get rid of the, you know, he's just my friend. I'm sorry. Guys don't want to be friends. And even if he's telling you that, and if you're beautiful, let me say something. If you're beautiful and you know it, that guy does not want to be your friend. Trust me. At the very least, he's getting something emotionally out of that. Okay. So at your age, you should be asking the question. I'm sorry, I'm just going there tonight for a minute. You should be asking the question, why is he spending any text time with me when he should be pursuing his wife? So, you know, wake up to that. Women are wired for friendship. They really believe this guy wants to be friends. For men, we know better. We know what's going on there. Women are turned on by emotions, through emotions. And that's why you might not even like the guy at first, but he's funny and you had a bunch of coffees with him and somehow you started to be attracted to him and you don't know why. Men, we're turned on and attracted by visual, by sight. So let's just clear the air here and tell it like it really is. So get rid of the foxes, you know, clear the way and enjoy this season. This season is for you and her. Everybody else gotta go. And I said to my wife, every time somebody contacted me, I told her about it. And I said, I'm not chatting with this person. I know what this is, you know, and we just cleared the air. We didn't have to. She didn't put handcuffs on me. I didn't put handcuffs on her. However, we chose to do that because we wanted to enjoy the season we're in. Honey, am I saying truthful things?
Yeah.
So far, is this okay? I just want to make sure. All right, so kick out the foxes. Bye-bye. Don't be afraid to not return that text. Don't be afraid to scene zone. Scene zone.
Amen, amen.
All right. Don't be afraid to scene zone those people. You owe, ladies, you owe that guy nothing. You owe him nothing. This has nothing to do with being a Christian brother or a Christian sister, and you need to be cordial and talk to this person, and you led him to the Lord 4 years ago and you're his connection. Let me tell you, soul ties that are produced by emotional intimacy can be turned on in a moment through chatting. Soul ties can emerge. Ooh. Okay, let's finish this up quick here. Now, verse 16 and 17, this is from the moment you say I do. This is the marriage right here. This is the wedding. This is the fulfillment of the promise. My beloved is mine. You can't say that unless you're married. Now when you're married, you belong to each other. My beloved is mine and I am his. We passed all the tests. We were patient. We kicked the foxes to the curb. My beloved is mine and I am his. Now, part of this, I don't know how much I can say, but you know, I've done such deep study on Song of Solomon that I'll try to word it properly, but he grazes among the lilies is absolutely sexual language, deep, deep romance. And I won't give you real definition of what that means, but it's absolutely the honeymoon, the wedding night, all of that. And then verse 17 is even more shocking. Until the day breathes away, or until the day breathes and the shadows flee away. That refers to all night, love making all night long, great sex life, incredible honeymoon, until the shadows, I don't like that translation. In the New American Standard, I wish, if anybody's got it, let's just quickly, Song of Solomon, chapter 2, and verse 17. You have the same, yeah. I think it's until the cool of the day or something and the shadows flee away. Turn, my beloved, be like a gazelle or a young stag on the cleft of the mountains. This is physical intimacy and consecration. Physical intimacy and consecration all night long. Deep, deep intimacy. Now, lastly, because I think you have some Q&A time here and all of that, and maybe if you desire it, I'll you know, we can pray for you.
Yeah, we can pray.
Okay. I want you to know something, and you don't have to agree with this, but I personally believe that God can restore virginity and God can restore purity. And I want to remind you, because I'll say it this way. Purity in your life is not gauged by I've done this many things right and only this many things wrong. Or some people say, I'm so pure, I've never kissed a boy. Like, what is that? You know, and does that mean the person who has kissed a boy is less pure than you, even though you're both believers? You know what I mean? Or I lost my virginity, I didn't lose my virginity, so somehow I have this higher rank in the area of purity. I want to make a statement here that's very clear. Jesus is our purity. Jesus is our purity. And when he comes into your life and forgives you of your sin, he makes you pure. Now, you know, you're going to want to tell the person that you're engaging with, and when the time is appropriate, look, here's what I've done in my life. You need to be open and honest. But the Lord can restore a level of purity to your life where you can live unashamed. That's the key right there. Because some of us are doing the things over and over again that we're getting in trouble with because of shame. And Jesus is our purity. Your works will never purify you. Your list of I kissed a boy or I didn't kiss a boy or I touched this person, I didn't touch this person. Or look, Jesus cleared the deck when he said, hey guys, if you even look at a woman lustfully, you've committed adultery in your heart. So we all have sinned. We all have failed. And I want you to know that tonight, Jesus can absolutely 100% restore and renew and give you his purity, because you will never be pure in and of your own strength. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Maybe Sam would like to share something before we can we'll pray. Sarah, you want to share something?
Uh-oh. That, yeah, right now. So just a little small. Pastor Derek is right about that. It's a way where, like us ladies, for me, the Lord showed me about that. Like Jesus is our purity. So indeed, he is, the Lord showed me this passage, like in Psalms, in the book of, Psalms and he mentioned about purify me with hyssop. Hyssop is by the blood of Jesus, we are cleansed. So that is the one that my heart really overflows, that I am as white as the snow. So that is what God has promised us, to have a pure heart. And you know what? Waiting is not enduring, but we must embrace it, because it is better to have the best person, or having the wrong motive or wrong person. So it's better to wait long than having the wrong person. So that is just my addition. And that is how I see also in my life, that waiting is to trust. Like, it is very nice once you put your trust, because waiting is part of trusting God and building on how you have to establish yourself first, learning how to build a firm foundation in this season of waiting, the season of waiting patiently, the season of being patient in God's timing. So that's all.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Thank you very much, Pastor Derek and Sarah, for your time really today. And yes, we will ask them to pray right now. I believe that we will not just pray for you guys, but you now represent the youth of the Philippines. And I believe with all my heart, you did not hear the message by accident, but a divine appointment. It's an entrustment at an endowment ng Lord sa atin, no, to carry this thing in your heart, because there's so much that needs to be done in our nation. Amen po ba?
Amen.
Amen. I ask Pastor Derek to pray an impartation among you youth leaders. I believe that you are not just youth leaders of the church, but God is positioning you to be leaders of our government in different mountains of the nation. Amen. How many are ready?
Amen.
All right, Pastor Derek.
Amen, amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. I want to pray for you. We want to pray for you. I think my wife will just agree with me here, unless you have something. Dear Father, in the name of Jesus, just open your hearts right now. We have been powerful impartation and powerful miracles taking place online. And God will do it right now. In fact, he's going to do it right now. Holy Spirit, I thank you that you're here. I ask you to increase your presence now in each person's house, right where they are. Someone, you're feeling a heat on your left hand right now. You're feeling a heat that just rushed through your left hand. It's a sign of God's presence over you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we release more of your anointing over each person, that you would give them the grace and the power for purity. We thank you, Lord, that purity is a power when we go out beyond the four walls into every sector of society. I thank you that purity increases the anointing of our lives. And I thank you that purity is actually a gift. It's actually this thing is so much better when it's done the right way. Lord, I pray you would just awaken in them and give them a grace to go the distance, to be able to be patient. Let the spirit of patience come upon them. Let them have a goal to prove their patience.
Amen.
Right now, Lord, I pray that for anyone who's having there's chronic or generational hindrances over your life that have been holding back some process that needs to happen. There's been delays that have not been of God. I just break you right now in the name of Jesus. There's a young guy on here and saying, I can hardly handle this thing. I have life inside of me. I have things I've done in my past. I can't seem to control. I pray deliverance. I speak deliverance, the word of deliverance over you right now in the name of Jesus. Where there is any unclean spirits that are causing this in your life, I command you out in the name of Jesus. We just rebuke every demonic power and unclean spirit that is attached to people from their past right now. There's a girl on this call. There's a young lady on this call, and you have just pressing sexual thoughts. Like, it's almost like every day, all day. And you think, is this even normal? And I just rebuke that right now in the name of Jesus. We break that off of you. We command it to leave you right now. What's causing that? The word of God, the Bible, needs to be in your hands. The washing of the water of the word that renews the mind. That's what you need right now. There's also somebody on this call. You're struggling with your sexual identity. You would describe it as you're confused. You know, you're not in a place. It's not like you're practicing it or living it out as yet, maybe, but you know you're confused in the area of your sexuality. And I just want to affirm and confirm that God has not made you that way. God was not the author of that, but this is the result of a broken world and struggles that we all face. The Bible says that, you know, we have not resisted yet to the point of blood, have you? This is a journey of resistance and seeking the Lord for total healing. And I release healing the same way, Lord, in the revival meetings that many lesbians, many people struggling with homosexuality were totally delivered. I release that anointing on this broadcast right now in the name of Jesus. Touch that person right now. Heal that trauma. Go to that part of their heart that needs to be adjusted. Go and touch their mind. Where there is any kind of challenges this way, go and touch their minds. In the name of Jesus, I release healing over you right now in Jesus' name. There's also, I'm sorry, there's somebody, I believe you're a girl. You are well away, like you, the situation happened, the sin happened like quite a while ago, at least 2 years ago. But the guilt and the shame has remained. The shame has remained. And I want to remind you that Jesus didn't just take your sin on the cross, but the Bible says he took our shame. You do not need to carry that shame. The devil has tried to trap you with shame. He couldn't get you to keep sinning, so he gave you shame. And it has actually hindered the anointing. It's hindered your ministry. It's hindered even your standards. You have lowered your standards because of shame on your life. You have lowered yourself. And the Lord says he's able to give you the desires of your heart. He will give you according to your faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. And so I break off shame right now off your life. We remove shame right now. Shame, go. There's a number of people struggling with shame. I command it to go. There's somebody, multiple ones of you struggling with masturbation, touching yourself, arousing yourself, and you wondered even, is it okay? It's okay if I compromise in this area. That habitual practice of masturbation and lusting in your mind has brought an unclean spirit of addiction to that. I break that off of you right now. Repent, right where you are. Repent, we break that off of you. You know what? You're going to make mistakes. This is a battle. It's like pride. It's like lust is like pride. It's an ever-present thing that we have to fight. And the New Testament says, I would that you not sin. I wish that you won't sin. But if you do sin, we have an advocate before the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is called righteous because we are not. We can boldly approach the throne of grace and find mercy. If our repentance is sincere, if our repentance is genuine, he will be faithful to forgive your sins 70 times, 7 times. I break off that spirit of masturbation now. Out in the name of Jesus. Somebody just felt something leave them. Out right now in the name of Jesus. The word of knowledge is coming so fast. I won't go long tonight here, but there's somebody you witnessed your mother having sexual relations inappropriately. You witnessed some stuff related to your mother that brought trauma. I break that off of you right now in Jesus' name. Pornography addiction, out in the name of Jesus. We repent of that. Just repent of all of that right now. There's an anointing for purity, but purity, you know, repentance precedes purity. You've got to repent. A number of years ago, when I was like, I don't know, I must have been 18, and I looked at some stuff online for a period of 3 months. I couldn't seem to stop at that age for those 3 months. And I went into I realized I was just praying these quick flare prayers. Oh, Lord, forgive me. And then I'd do it again. Oh, Lord, forgive me. And I'd do it again. Finally, I said, man, this isn't repentance. I'm just asking God to make sure I still get into heaven. And then I go and do that thing again. And I went into the bathroom and I locked the door. And I sat in a bathtub with no water. It was uncomfortable. It was cold. And I said, God, I'm not leaving here until you deliver me of that thing, until you can help me repent. I've been doing that thing for long enough over those 3 months that my heart was hardened to it. I no longer was feeling conviction. And I stayed there praying and trying to cry, even trying to have a broken heart over it. But I refused to leave that bathtub. I refused to leave that room until the Lord touched my heart and showed me how he feels about it. And at around 45 minutes, tears began to stream down my face as I understood how the Lord sees it. I felt conviction. And only then could I genuinely repent, and forgiveness met my repentance. And then deliverance came and met my repentance. And I was totally delivered of that thing from that time. So it's got to be real. It's got to be sincere. We're praying prayers of repentance now, and that's enough on a certain level. But for some of you, you've got to go deeper and be honest with God and say, Lord, I like this thing. I enjoy this. I can't seem to stop. I need your help. I can't do it. Show me. Pursue.
Hallelujah.
Pursue a heart that follows after purity and that just will not settle for anything less. I bless you with this tonight in Jesus' name. Do you have anything, Sarah?
Yes, so I just feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit right now. There are some of you who are here in Zoom or watching you in YouTube or Facebook. There's someone here like you feel like you're not worthy to serve in God's kingdom because of your past. I want you to tell. I want to tell you right now, it's not about the past. God is not interested about your past. God has a greater dream for your life.
Yeah.
You just need to repent. Repentance is turning away from sin. You need to just lift your hands, open your heart towards God. And you know what? There is a greater calling over your life right now. Just ask God. Cry out to God wherever you are. Whenever, like, Lord, I need your presence. And you know what? The Lord is showing you that heart, the heart that you are, God is exposing you to this dream that he has for you. Do not dwell on the past, because God is not interested in the past situation that you have. He is interested on the future, in the dream. God has a bigger, greater dream for you. And right now, I just want to release that prayer. Heavenly Father, I apply the blood of Jesus. If who is that person right now, Lord, continue to talk to him or her, Lord God, in dreams. Open the vision, Lord God. Open heaven. And I pray right now that you will continually, Lord, speak.
Yes, amen.
Pray that the fire will continually be lightened up, that he, she will not be ashamed of the gospel, but they will just pour out the glory upon glory to glory. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for your love for us. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Glory to God. And I want to bring all the glory and honor to living God.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Can we just pray once more? I'm just led also today. The Lord is telling the Filipino youth, God is healing even youth that are being trafficked and victims of prostitution. Somebody's watching right now and you've been trading your life, but God is telling you today that he is doing something in your life, and now that you want it out of your life, God is giving you a way of escape today. God is giving you that way ngayon. Hallelujah. And maybe I'll ask Elaine, because right now I just sense the anointing of the Lord upon her to pray in behalf of the youth of the nation.
Amen.
Elaine, yes, go ahead.
Yes, Lord, we continue to pray, oh God, and to battle, Lord God, for the lives of these young people, oh Lord. Lord, the enemy has stolen so much from them, oh God. So much purity, Lord God. So much sense of worth, Lord. This generation has lost their worth, their identity, oh God. Their value, oh Lord. They don't know how valuable they are and how precious you have made them to be, oh God. And right now, Lord, we speak, oh God, and we rebuke the lies, oh God, that's covering them, that it's okay to give in. It's okay to commit mistakes, to give their lives from one man to another, Lord God. And we declare, oh Lord, that they will be exposed, Lord God, to your kindness. They will be exposed, oh God, to your great intentions for their lives. Lord, how valuable they are, how precious you have made your young ladies to be, oh God, and how you intended men, oh God, to stand, oh God, and be responsible to the decisions that they're going to make. Lord, we're taking back, oh God, in the name of Jesus, what is rightfully theirs, oh God. We're fighting, oh God, against what the enemy has been stealing, has been killing, and has been taking away from them, oh God. In the name of Jesus, I pray that you would raise a generation, oh God, a generation who would pursue purity, oh God. I pray that you would raise a generation who would win the younger generation, who would bring back the generation into your original design for them, into your original plans for their lives, oh God. Use these young men and women, oh God, as your agents, Panginoon, to speak value, Lord, and to speak morality upon their generation, oh God. Lord, we're tired hearing, Panginoon, on how a young girl gets to bring back a child, Panginoon, out of young age, Panginoon. We're tired hearing stories, Panginoon, of in ignorance, Panginoon, on what to deal, whom to talk to, Panginoon, how to talk about the issues that they're going through. But God, use this platform, oh God, to educate, oh Lord, and to restore what has been stolen and what has been dead in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Wow.
Amen. Wow.
Thank you, Jesus.
God is really moving. Amen. Kahit na we're in a different places,
yes,
we cannot limit God's hand. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
Woo! I feel it. Yes. So thank you again. Thank you, Pastor Derek and Ate Sarah, for sharing how you waited for God's perfect time. And ayan, siguro yung mga boys natin, yung mga men natin, maybe they're thinking, they're planning to make their intentions known.
Yeah.
Okay, so the learning is not yet done. Yeah. So we've got to take advantage of this time to learn more. Amen. So we can ask questions and be encouraged with their answers. So handa na po ba tayo? Are we ready? So yes. Sa mga nasa YouTube live, you can just drop your questions sa ating comment section. So for question number one.
Alpha.
Yes po.
Special mention.
We have Justin, Pastor M, wants to greet Pastor Derek.
Welcome.
Hello, Pastor.
I miss you and Pastor Sara.
Yes. Ninong.
Yes. I'm interceding for you while you are speaking and sharing while
Amen.
I go.
Amen.
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, the fire of God fell, Pastor M, so you've
been Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Okay, so, you know, Sarah, we call the mentors here Big Ate and Big Kuya. So, yeah. So sometimes they call us the Big Ates and the Big Kuyas. So Big Kuya Derek will answer the questions tonight.
Kuya Derek.
Like,
yes, Big Kuya.
What are those kuya here?
Big kuya.
They're saying kuya. They don't have kuya and ate, you know, they're just called by name.
Yes. Yeah, so, you know, in the Asian, we have this Japanese name and they have this English name. So in the Philippines, we have like that also in the Life Hub. So that's why they call me Ina, that's mother. Ina Ganda is beautiful mother.
Wow.
Amalakas.
Strong
father. Yes, because in the Philippines also, we do not have the legend of the weak and the ugly. We only have the legend of beautiful and strong. Si Malakas and Maganda.
Yeah.
Wow, wow, wow. I didn't know. So I learned something.
Okay, I'm just giving them a minute to organize their thoughts because they have 10 questions lined up here. But it's in Taglish, so I hope Sarah can translate.
I have Micah here to translate English.
Okay. Okay, go ahead, Micah and Alpha and everyone. So we want to say hi to the Iligan youth leaders, Chris, Mark, and Micah,
hi.
And Shama. And also Freddie in Dubai. Freddie. Yes.
Hello.
Okay. That's it. Sir Alpha?
Yes, Pop. Number one.
Some questions you have gathered, right?
Yes, Pop.
Yes, Pop.
Okay. You're just the spokesperson.
Yes. Okay, so Pastor Derek or Kuya Derek? Kuya? You seem to have really enjoyed your season of waiting and you knew that it was your season. We are curious. How will we know that it is our season to wait?
Oh, wow. What a great question. Firstly, when the person said it seemed like I enjoyed it. No, I did not enjoy waiting. You know, it's waiting, it's difficult.
Yeah.
Being patient is challenging. And so don't judge yourself for, you know, struggling with that because it's not easy. And, you know, endurance can only come when there's resistance. So it has to be a challenge, and it is a challenge. And is the question, how do I know if that person is the one? Or is the question, how do I know if I'm in a season of waiting?
How will you know if you are in the season of waiting?
I think one of the fundamental ways that you know is you won't feel peace about the people you're engaging with. And it'll seem like maybe that person would be good logically, or they're beautiful, or they may even have so many things on paper, like what you would want, but you can't get this peace. You can't feel this. You know, and so that's another reason. But you should also approach the season of waiting very logically. So there's some questions you need to ask yourself. Are you whole without that person? Because only when you're whole are you at a place where you can give to that person. Marriage is not about taking, it's about giving. And are you really whole? I had areas of my life where, you know, I looked like I had it all together in 99 things. And there was a percentage of my life where I had some emotional immaturity due to woundedness as a in my mother's womb, you know. And there was emotional immaturity there. And God needed to work on that. So it took me a little longer to deal with that. And we don't always realize that God's trying to do things in your life. So ask yourself, are you ready? Are you mature enough? Can you support that person? Like I see some men pursuing women and I think, where is she going to live? You know, you have nothing to offer her. you don't even know what your calling is. So, you know, number one is, do you know who you are? That's number one. Have you found yourself whole and complete within yourself? Number two, are you walking in right relationship with God? No, are you walking in right relationship with God? Number three, do you know your calling and purpose? You know, Adam was given his purpose, you know, and then Eve was brought to him. So you need to know what your calling and purpose is. What number are we on?
Number two
or three or something. Well, the next one is that on a physical, psychological level, the part of your brain that can make rational decisions that are not based on untrustworthy emotions, so you can decide, you can make proper, healthy emotional decisions, isn't fully developed until age 24. Around age 24, you are fully developed in that area and you just make better decisions. That is to say that the person that you think you would want at 19 years old might be completely different desires when you hit your early 20s. Now, I know a lot of people in the Philippines got married at 18, 19, all of that, and it worked out fine for them. That's great. Yeah, hallelujah. I mean, you know, that's good. So that's not the one and only condition. But so you're going to know your season of waiting because some of those things in your life won't be mapped out properly. And then the final one is, listen, once you're married, it's for life. And there may be some things you want to do when you're single. Singleness is a massive blessing. You're all going to get married, I'm sure. And it's for life. But the amount of things I was able to do as a single, I was able to travel. I was able to write books. I was able to fully develop our ministry, fully explore who I am as a man. I was able to learn things and really walk with God on levels that were just so close and intimate that, you know, I just wouldn't be in a rush. I would tell you, don't despise the season of waiting. Because trust me, you will really be able to live. If you can get off the fantasy, I see a lot of fantasy in the Philippines with, if I can just get married, then my life will be settled. If I can just find that person, that void will be filled. Nope. You will find the areas in your life that still need work only get bigger when you enter into marriage. So enjoy your season of waiting. It's a gift.
Amen. 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 Yes. Pastor Reggie has a question.
Yes. So
from the man.
Pastor Derek or Kuya Derek. So for me, this is a second question that I'm going to ask.
We're asking for a friend. You're asking for a friend too, right?
Okay. Okay, so this is a question. What is the role of learning to honor people around you in the season of waiting? Or waiting is an independent, just an individual work? Did you get that, Pastor?
You know, let me make sure I get it right. You mean, you know, as you're having to wait, do you mean you need to be honoring the women around you or honoring your parents' opinions, or clarify your answer a bit more?
Honoring the people around.
Maybe the people that's helping him in his waiting time, or the first question would be, who should be he honoring in this season?
Mm-hmm. that may be part of the question too.
The environment.
He's asking if the learning to wait is
something to do with honoring, like
I think, and hopefully I answer this right. I mean, we always should be honoring everybody in our lives, but waiting will force you to honor. You know, you have to honor women. You have to honor your friends. You have to honor pastors' opinions, parents' opinions. I mean, honor is like an investment that brings a blessing. when you invest, when you sow honor into the people around you, God will bless you one way or another through those people. And so honor is a really safe place to be, as well as honor is a weapon of spiritual warfare. When you go through difficult and challenging situations, you choose to honor, you defeat the enemy and his plans in your life. So I don't know if I answered that properly, but look, honor, you're always safe. You're always going to walk in blessing when you walk in honor. You can trace every success that you've had in your life. You can trace back to someone somewhere you have honored. Every failure that you've ever had in your life, you can trace back to someone somewhere that you have dishonored.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you so much, Pastor Reggie.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. So, another question. Why is it that it feels like nothing is happening while I'm waiting?
Yeah. I'll tell you why. There are some things.
Very honest question, Pastor.
I'm sorry?
That's a very honest question.
Yeah, because I felt that way. I thought something was wrong with me, to be honest. I thought that, you know, I was going to end up single the rest of my life. That's what I really thought. And I made so many mistakes along the way, because when you feel like nothing's happening, you'll try to birth it in the flesh. So Abraham received this promise that he's going to have a child, and then nothing was happening. And he ended up having an illegitimate child with the servant girl, Hagar. And so when it feels like nothing is happening, it's the ultimate time to prove your patience before God. That's the time where you focus on your calling, focus on developing yourself, and you can really prove your faith during that time, because you're not alone. Guys in the Bible had to wait 7 years, 10 years, 20 years, 40 years. Abraham's old, you know, this kind of thing. That's the time where you can really prove things. So if you feel like nothing is happening, just take it as an opportunity to prove your patience before God, and to focus on your calling and get know yourself. Focus on singleness. Believe me, you'll be amazed when you settle in that area. It's funny how that person appears, you know, because oftentimes when we feel like nothing's happening, God is doing very deep character work. And there's some things, there's some, you know, I'll word it to you this way. There are some things as far as preparation, the preparation you need for later. There are some things that only a process of time can do in your heart. Only waiting can do some things in your heart. So though it tarries, I mean, that's for you. Though it delays, wait for it. Yes. It surely, I prophesy that over you. It will surely come. And sometimes God is working on her. Maybe God's dealing with her heart. Pray for your future spouse, whoever she is.
Yes.
Yes.
For her during the time of waiting. Maybe the waiting you're feeling is God is preparing her for you, so that he gives you the best gift. Maybe you're a good looking, anointed, awesome guy, and you're just there, and God wants to make sure that the person he brings to you is worthy of you.
Amen.
Your life. Sabotage your life.
That's my daughter.
Either. It can do either. You marry the wrong person, yes. Not prepared to go the distance. And Reggie, just because you were so open and honest and transparent here, Pastor Reggie, human beings have free will.
Yes.
And a woman can choose to be obedient to the Lord or not. A man can choose their will. Don't doubt that God is testing her. God wants to see what she's going to do and whether she's a helpmate suitable for you. Pray her in, brother. If you've got time to spare, if you're waiting at the gate of the airplane, you know, get to work on your calling, pray for her, but focus on changing the world. Because even when you marry, you think, ah, okay, everything will be settled. I'm married now. I achieved the highest goal. And then some months go by and you're pressed to fulfill your calling. So focus on your calling during the waiting period.
Thank you, Pastor.
But I just want to add something upon the time of waiting, prayer in waiting. So, because I experienced this and asking God in prayer, like, Lord, not only is he the right person for me, or am I the right person for him? Wow. So include that in your prayer. And that is said. That way also.
Yes, thank you, Ate Sara.
Okay, yes.
Wow. Wow. Wow.
Thank you, Lord, for answers.
Okay.
Another questions. How many questions do we have more? Alpha?
Madam. Okay, I have another question. Okay. For a friend, asking for a friend.
Yeah. Okay, so thank you, friends, for sharing your questions.
Thank you, friends.
Thank you so much. Okay, so holding on to the promise of God, pouring out his spirit upon all flesh, and we can have dreams, but what if the dream was not from God? But I know that I am a praying daughter.
Yeah. Oh, man. You know,
go faster there.
Let me just say something. You know, the amount of emails I got in my single time of women who had dreams, visions, signs and wonders, you would think that God was multi-personality. Like, there were so many that had dreams and visions. And you know what? I had several times, and I fancy myself a friend of God. I had multiple times where I thought I heard something from God about this person. Whoa, was it wrong? Because you're dealing with an issue of life that is highly emotionally charged and even demonically charged. So you'll even get false dreams. And we don't have time tonight, but this is for the high level seasoned ones here. You can get some dreams and some stuff and some prophecies that can be totally not of God. They can be a soul. They can be demonically inspired. It can be witchcraft. You name it, I've got a story about it. Trust me, in ministry, I've got all kinds of stuff having to do with this. So the question is, as a praying person, first and foremost, don't live in fear. Live in faith. Function from a place of faith. Be more of faith in God's power to keep you than the devil's ability to deceive you. Secondly, make sure you're not in sin. Unrepentant, habitual sin gives the enemy legal right to mess with you. So if you've got this soulish thing going on with somebody on chat or whatever, you know, you're going to end up having some kind of dream, and the enemy was permitted to bring that to you because you are playing around with something. It's what said of Cain and Abel, sin is crouching at the door. So get the sin out of your life. You know, that would be number two. And then number three is the decision of who you're going to spend the rest of your life with is too big a decision to base it solely on dreams, visions, and stuff like that, because sometimes we miss it. Sometimes we don't get it right. The Bible says we see in part. So at this point, you might be thinking, well, how do I choose then? What do I base it on? I have a several level criteria that I use. One, do I have revelation from God about this person? So we want the spiritual. Do I have revelation? And if I feel I have revelation, ask for more revelation. Put God to the test. God is able to speak to you in a way that you know it's him. Secondly, do I have some level of affirmation and peace coming from my mentors and pastors and those who know me? How did they react to it? That's another evidence. So I gather all the evidence up in the court of law, in God's court. So spiritual, the people around me, how do they feel about it? Thirdly, practically speaking, do I enjoy spending time with this person? You know how many people I know that hated spending time together, but they got married because God told them to, and they were divorced within a year. You know how many times that, do you enjoy this person? Is this person fun? You know what I liked about Sarah? Like, telling you the honest truth, we laughed, we have fun, it's easy, she blesses me, she, you know, she cooks for me, I love to make her coffee. We just have a great time. Even if we weren't believers, we just have a great time together. This is a cool person. I like being around her. I can be with her every moment of every day and never be tired of her. Mm-hmm. Never be. I want to be around her as much as she will allow me. I just.
Same with me, Kuya Derek.
All right. I'm your Kuya.
Yes, Kuya.
Yeah. So, you know, unsaved people get married all the time, and many of them have happy marriages because they just chose somebody they enjoyed. So practically, then logically speaking, does this logically make sense? Are we of appropriate age? Do we have the things in place that make for an easy road or a very difficult road? You know, so there's a lot that you want to put together. Now, notice there, I didn't really mention prophecy, dreams, visions. Here's the final piece. The highest level of the voice of God is not dreams, visions, all of that prophetic. The highest level of the voice of God is the inner peace that comes by the Holy Spirit leading you. The inner peace. The Bible says, let the peace of God guard your heart. That word there, guard, is like an umpire of a sporting match, like in a soccer game or football game. Let the peace of God call the shots. That's the highest level of discernment, is an inner knowing, an inner peace, and an inner leading. Last, I really want to give to this person that asked this. You might be thinking, there's only one person for me. And if I don't hit the target, I'm going to be single the rest of my life. And if that one person, he needs to know, pastor needs to lay hands on him. God, you need to speak to him that he's the one for me and the only one. Listen, the perfect will of God for your life is not a tiny dot target that you've got to try to hit, or a tightrope walk that you're going to fall off. There are multiple decisions and opportunities that come under the perfect will of God. And if that person uses their free will to leave you or whatever, God will send you something better. There are lots of people that God can bring along your path who will knock your socks off. So don't be afraid. Take the fear out of it. God has somebody for you. He'll make it clear. He'll make it clear.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. So, Ate Mika got lost the connection. Oh. Yeah. Okay, now connecting again. Risa, Mana has a question.
Mana.
Okay.
Mana has a question.
With all.
Go, Mana.
Yeah. The question is it true that first love never dies?
Ano yan? Asking for a friend?
Asking for a friend.
For a friend again?
Not me.
I saw that movie on Netflix. Oh, yeah. Love can... are you talking about like... do you mean it in context of like the first guy that you dated and fell in love with and that will be perfect? But it will never go away kind of thing?
Mana, go ahead. Yes.
Okay. All right. Look.
Yeah, or
first love can always die off. It's why Jesus told the church in Revelation, hey, you've left your first love. You need to return to your first love. So first love can definitely die. If that thing is not of God and it's not dead yet, it's probably a soul tie or a fantasy. And you need to kill it. It needs to be put on the altar and it needs to be burned up. What's born of the flesh will never become spirit. And you need to get rid of it. And one of the best ways to cut off the kind of love that never dies thing is by stopping all communication and all visual. So block them on Instagram, block them so you don't have to see them all the time. And cut that thing out of your life. And you'd be surprised. The more you crucify that thing, the more likely you are for the real thing that's born of the spirit to come. So first love, second love, you can even be married. And that person who you love, their love can grow cold for you over a period of years. That doesn't mean you divorce. It means you've got to ask the Lord to help you get back to that place. And you know, marriage is not even based on like love per se. Marriage is based on commitment, vows you made. And you commit your life to that person for the rest of your life. And you'll have times where that love feels cold. And your heart can be hardened and you need to ask Holy Spirit to come in and, you know, do that again. So love is not the dictator of who you should be with. It doesn't mean it's a sign you're to be with that person. Ladies, yes. Ladies, you got to watch out for the fantasy. I've seen your Filipino movies out here. I have seen... I'm well aware. I've heard all the talking about it. And marriage is for adults. Marriage is for purpose and calling. Procreation, joy, yes. Pleasure, yes. But marriage is work. Marriage is work.
Yeah. Amen.
It's another ministry. Amen.
Okay. Follow-up question yata kay Riza.
Yes.
Ate, okay, there. Signal. Ate Riza or Micah?
Ate Mik?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, follow-up question po. When will I know that my waiting time is over?
This year.
Your waiting has come to an end. You know what? The simple answer to that is let God show you. Let God be the one to end the time of waiting. Let him make it obvious. And follow that criteria. What is your heart saying? What do you have the peace of God in your heart? Do you have revelation? Do you have affirmation from parents around you? Does it make sense practically? Do you know the person logically? Most important question too is, do you have the same values? Mm-hmm. Values is really what you want to look for. Similar values make for a better long-term relationship. And so if you don't have any of those and God isn't making it known, like I met Sarah, man, I tried everything to get married. I failed 1,000 times. And you know what? When I met Sarah, I was avoiding that. And even some of the feelings I had, because I thought Sarah was not available for that season. And you know what? On the third day of the training, before I came to the hall, I was in my room and I began to weep in deep intercession. I didn't know why. I thought it was just for the Philippines or for the meeting that day. And I didn't know that God was going to give her a revelation and me a revelation. And I got a revelation. But then we had to practically walk that out by communicating, talking to the parents, going through the process. And my parents were mad at me, actually, over this. I'll tell you why. 3 days of knowing Sarah, and it was like distance at that point because you went to Manila and I was up on the mountain there. And I was like, telling my parents by text. I was like, I think I met my wife. And my parents were so mad because, like, how can you say that? You don't know. You need to, you know, parents were being objective and they were right in some ways. But let me tell you something. There was, I know that I know that I know. There, I became like a lion. This was it. And ask God to give you that. Ask God to give you that criteria that I listed. And your season of waiting will be gone. It seems hard now. But when it comes, you think, it wasn't so bad.
Yeah.
Yes. I think Davao people have two questions.
Sure.
Yes.
Pastor M, you look good with that goatee thing there. You're looking good.
Okay. Let's go, George.
Kasi Ate Nod siya ta, di ba kanyo?
Yes.
Hi. Hello, Pastor Derek. I'd just like to ask, how much money should I prepare before marriage?
Very good.
In dollars or in pesos, George? Good question.
Nice.
Very good question.
George, is your pastor listening right now?
I really need to know.
Okay, yeah. You deserve an answer.
My mentor's school of preparation for marriage, they really major on the money piece. That's one of the requirements, absolutely. Here's my best answer to you. Number one, you should be able to pay for at least half of the cost of the wedding. That would be number one. You should be able to pay for at least half or work something out with her that she can, you know. Number two, you should be able to support the two of you so that she doesn't have to ever work. Even though she might want to work and she'll have her calling, you should have enough money that the two of you can live comfortably and she doesn't have to ever work. So if you were the only one working, your family could survive. And you should have enough money, third level, you should have enough money to be able to surprise her with monetary gifts and gift giving. So the level that you should have is you should be able to buy her candy. You should be able to buy her jewelry. You should be able to buy her whatever it is in your culture or whatever. And then when she has her first baby, you should be able to give her money as thanks for having your child. And, you know, next child, you should be able to bless her in some way. You know, I have a setting in place that COVID kind of crashed, but every month I have enough money budgeted for Sarah to receive flowers. Every so often I take her shopping, and she really hates this. I don't know why, but we went to the store. I said, dear, I want to buy this for you. I want to dress you up. We go into the store and I give her accessories and put clothes on her and try different outfits. And she's so uncomfortable because she thinks, no, we could save this money. And you know, you should be able to bless her above and beyond. That would be my best answer to you. And one more. You should be able to live independently of your parents.
Okay. I do have follow-up questions. Question. Pastor. What should I do first, to have a house or a wedding? I mean,
that is such a great question. I really like this guy, George, because this is such truthful question right here.
Yeah, in reality.
I really need to be in, because this is what I've been waiting.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be a house. You should be able to get for her your own living arrangement, either an apartment, a flat, or somewhere. You should be able, the determining factor is this, you should be able to live independent of your parents. If you are, when you live with your parents as a newlywed couple, it brings great challenges. And we've been blessed. Because it's easy to live with the cabanlets. We're here locked down because of COVID, not because I can't support her. But you should be able to live independently of parents. I think it's totally inappropriate to get married and then live like children under your parents' roof. They will behave like parents. You will behave like children. You can have all kinds of in-law clashes. It's not a healthy situation. You need to be alone with her. You need to be able to walk around the house wearing almost nothing or nothing at all. You need to have your own intimacy with her.
All right. Thank you so much, Pastor Derek. I take note of that.
Yeah, and you know what else? A lot of people, when they get married, it's a tiny little house of sticks. That's fine. If she likes where you're living, if she's happy being with you and you're happy being with her, just don't live with your parents, but get that house of sticks and enjoy newly married life.
Right. Okay.
Oh, Alpha.
Yes. Pastor, we have another question from Davao. So the question is, tama, Davao, right? So does God will still honor my waiting season even if I'm already in a relationship? Or waiting is only applicable to single people?
From a friend.
From a friend.
Well, you know what? If you are in a relationship during your waiting period, you are deceiving yourself. You are deceiving yourself. If God has called you to wait, you need to wait. You need to give 100% to that season. To everything in life, there is a season, the Bible says. So if you're in a relationship while you're supposed to be waiting for your spouse, you're saying that the person you're with right now is not your husband or wife, and you're not sure about them, you're asking for trouble. You're cheating the system, and God's blessing probably isn't on that, and you do not want to get into the ring without God's blessing on the relationship. So don't play around with somebody. In fact, your waiting season, I've known some people whose waiting season has gone until they're 50 years old, 40 years old, because they're hanging around somebody and it became a soul tie. And they never really did get God's best because they couldn't cut that thing off. Take it to the altar, kill it, cut the person off, and prepare yourself for God's best for you.
Yes, that's right.
Amen. Okay, so we have another question from Hong Kong.
Wow.
Yes. So the question is, what piece of advice you can give to those who are in a cross-cultural relationship in establishing a healthy communication, especially that speaking in English is not your first language?
Yeah. But this,
both of them are non-English speakers.
Oh.
Ah, okay. So they speak a totally different language from each other?
Yes. They can speak English, but
as a second language,
not really their main language.
Okay. This was the thing my parents were concerned about. Cross-cultural relationships can work. God can even do that for you, but they're high risk because the differences are very, very prevalent. And especially if you don't speak the language, you just need to know there's a lot you're missing out on. There's nuances, there's attitudes, there's things you're not picking up on. And you're not close enough living with the person for that to become real. And so you're kind of getting a surprise package. And so I like what I was told was that if it's going to be a cross-cultural relationship, you need to have special revelation from God on that. And you need to have real extra signs, extra assurance, because you just don't know the person as well. Cultural differences do play a big role. It affects family culture. It affects how you raise children. It affects how you handle finances. It affects all kinds of things. The marriages in general that work out best are people of the same culture, same values, similar demographic and age. That's not the rule. That's just the norm. Those do better. That's why many arranged marriages don't end in divorce, because they're chosen based on values, family, all of that. So there are risks in cross culture, but it's not that God can't do it. I'm Canadian, she's Filipino. We're having a great time. We have no problems. But you need special revelation. And take your time and prove that thing.
Okay. I think we're going to have another module on cross cultural relationship. We can to address that concern of those that are in the life hub also, because we want to be of help. Yeah, I have a son-in-law, he's also non-Filipino, but we get to patch things up, and the bottom line is the issue of the heart will be able to settle things. And just like the from Luzon and Mindanao is also extreme opposite cultures and tradition. And the challenge, I believe, is there's still challenge. Like, we have so much difference.
Yes, that's true.
And keep in mind, like, all of our cultural stuff has to bow the knee to kingdom culture. So if you're both believers, you've got a Bible filled with the culture of how we are to behave. So it just means you may have to make some compromises for each other in certain areas and be understanding of each other. But like Canadians and Filipinos especially do really well together because of the cultures sync well. So sometimes you just need to work at it a little harder. But that doesn't mean that person isn't for you. Marriage takes work. So if you really want that person, you love that person, you'll be willing to go through those challenges.
Yeah.
Yes. And love overcome culture.
Whoa.
Go, Ama. May one liner na si Ama. Yes. Pastor, last one question.
Last one set.
Sorry, questions are pouring. Okay, so the question is, what if you can't leave the parents? I think this is a follow-up question. What if you can't leave the parents because the parent is a single mom and we were the only one left to take care of her? This is in consideration of Filipino culture.
Great question. You know, you can never go wrong by honoring your father and your mother, that your days may be many. And when you choose to honor your parents, that is a great blessing. So if both of you agree to that, it's not mandated by the Bible or mandated by God that you must live with your mother and take care of her. So that's not a moral issue, although it might be for you. That could be cultural, that could be a value system. If you feel in your heart to do that and you both agree, that's a great idea. Bless your mother, take care of her, honor your parents. If that's your way of honoring, you know, absolutely do that. That's not a bad thing. That's a, you know, special occasion.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Okay, may mga humihirit pa, Sarah. How many more minutes do we have time with you, Pastor Derek?
We could do maybe another until 9:45.
Okay, 9:45. So that gives time for a question from Camp 7. Dawis, Team Dawis. Go.
Yeah, I think it's not a question, but I think it's in addition to what Pastor Derek was saying a while back when it comes with the question of George on how much to prepare and what to prepare. I think it's a matter of when we were preparing for our marriage, we only had few because I also married a pastor, And you know, we were independent in the preparation of the wedding, and Ina encouraged us that the first miracle of Jesus was in a marriage, in a wedding. Sorry, in a wedding. So, indeed, as I hear young couple testifying on marriage and weddings, we saw miracles in our marriage, in our wedding time. But more than the preparation of wedding itself is the preparation of the marriage. So, I think what Pastor Derek was mentioning a while back is that part of our preparation for the marriage is the preparation of our finances. So we also need to prepare our finances for just so we can also avoid circumstances where or compromises just because we did not prepare for the marriage itself. So I think that's what I was just want to add.
It's a good word. Yep. Yeah. Great, Elaine.
Okay, yes, we have a thank you for that, Elaine. Make safe yung mga pastors, and ha, it's good. Any more you would like to add? Thank you. No more na, ma? Yes, it's 9:30, so let's see. Let's have a group picture while we are waiting. Before we ask everyone to, from all the things that have been said tonight, you know, when we go to school, we always bring baon. Baon is what you put in your lunchbox. So before they go home tonight or they go to sleep or end the Zoom, let's see what's in their lunchbox or what's in their baon boxes today. Okay, so while you are preparing, Ate Alpha is going to take a picture. So let's show your video, Van, Roy, Ijoms, Shama, Riza. Yay! Okay. Man, are you taking picture? Yeah. All right.
Are you ready?
Shama, we're waiting for Shama and Chris Mark.
Hi, everyone. Yeah.
Yes, finish.
Again, what? One more. One, two, three, smile. All right.
Yes. All right. So, Sarah and Pastor Derek, as they give their one-liner, just for fun, you can answer that if they have to wait or if they have to wait patiently based on what they will have to say. Okay.
I don't know if I got
wait it. Or wait patiently. Wait for more.
One liner.
Ayan. Okay. Kayo magbigay ng score kung ano, they have to wait or they have to wait more patiently. Okay.
Yeah. We score them.
Okay. We score them from that. If they have to wait or if they have to wait patiently.
Okay.
Ah. Okay. Okay.
I think I got it. Yeah.
Yes. So where should we start? From the north or from the south? From the east or from the west? Okay. From the Middle East. Reggie, are you ready?
From the Middle East.
Middle East.
Yes. Middle na east pa. Sige, antayin natin si Reggie. Okay, bago si Reggie, bago si Freggie, si Reggie. Si Reg. Let's see.
Okay. So this is my one-liner.
Scoring will be based on their discernment.
Okay, so this is my one-liner as I quote, and I got this from Pastor Derek a while ago when he was sharing the message. This is my one-liner. Patience is proven long time ago. If it is delayed, just wait patiently. That's it.
Hey, parang ano, i-rephrase natin na angkinin natin, like ano yung gagawin mo na ngayon?
Like, okay.
What is now your decision from that baon?
If if my waiting is delayed, then I will wait patiently. Yes.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay.
What do I say?
I think they will all talk together.
Yeah, I think from what you feel for Pastor Reggie.
You need to wait
patiently.
Yeah, I mean wait patiently.
Okay, thank you, Piraj. Next. George.
Yes, all right. So like what Amma said, love breaks culture. And I would also love to add that love breaks struggle. Yeah. And if God delayed something for my waiting, that means I really have to be strong and be founded with His word and be founded well in finances. That's it.
You know, for me, wait patiently and wait is the same thing. That's why I'm struggling with the difference between wait patiently.
It's just addition.
Yes. It's just the level of waiting and hoping.
So if I say wait, it's just like, it's coming.
Wait. Go, maybe go, yeah.
Maybe. Yeah. Something like that, Pastor. Yeah.
Or wait.
Speed versus wait patiently.
Yeah.
So, okay, well, let's try it.
I'm trying to ask Pastor Derek, like, what's the difference between speed or wait patiently? So it's the same, he said.
I said, yeah. I think there's an emphasis in patiently.
Okay.
I think the length, it's the length.
the length.
You're prolonging the wait. The waiting.
Thank you. Oh, got it. All right, I'm ready. Go George. Again, George.
Sorry, George.
Thank you for waiting patiently. Now go again.
Okay, George.
Right.
In the presence of your pastor watching.
Hi, Pastor. I just want to, like what Amma said, love breaks culture, and then love also breaks struggle. Love also breaks something that it's not from the Lord. And then if God delayed waiting, it is for me to be strong and to be founded with this word and to have financial breakthrough. First, to have a love life. That's it.
Wait patiently.
All right. Okay.
George is graduating this year, and she will also enroll in WLI.
Oh yeah, you need to be patient. Then.
So patient.
Yeah, that's correct.
Then. That's all a confirmation. Right. Good confirmation.
Okay, good.
Alpha.
Yeah, you raise your hand if you're ready. Para ano. Yeah, Alpha is ready.
I'm ready.
No, you're not. Just kidding. Just joking.
I'm ready to receive the answer of just wait. Okay. My one-liner is, this is the best season for me to grow and walk rightly with God until the season of waiting is over.
Just wait.
Yeah, wait.
Wait and check.
Thank you.
Malapit na, Alpha.
Parang ama. Okay. Riza.
Riza.
Yeah. What I have here tonight is
patience show us the real value of what we are waiting for.
Great.
Yeah. What do you think, Pastor Derek?
So just wait, Risa. Just wait.
Woo! Thank you.
Desiree.
Kai kami eh.
I like the wallpaper. Oh.
Desiree, China is watching.
China?
From China?
Amen. My wine liner is don't allow waiting to become a habit. Leave your dreams and take risks. Life is happening now.
Wow. Wow. Okay. May I ask how old you are? Your age? What for a question for Desiree, what is your age?
Des, pakiayos yung speaker mo. You're choppy. Wala.
We can.
Ayun.
Natapos na si Des.
What's your age daw tinatanong?
Age daw.
Pastor, I'm just 14 years old. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Wait patiently and then
oh yeah.
Yeah.
My problem.
Okay, next.
Alpha, go ahead. Ate Mika.
Okay. Trust God in the process of waiting and enjoy the season of waiting.
May kasama ka ba? Makasama ka ba?
That's a hard one to answer. But just wait, Alpha. It's Alpha, right?
Micah.
Oh, it's Micah. Wait. There you are. Just wait, Micah. Just wait.
Next year, Micah. Don't be rash.
My side comment, yeah, Mike.
Don't be rash.
It's coming soon. It's coming soon.
Don't rush down.
2021.
Okay.
Yes.
Next. Van Xavier.
Hi. Good evening po ba? Hi, everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Hi. Hello.
Yeah, we hear you.
We can hear you.
Choppy po ba? Or not?
No, you're coming clear.
Okay. okay. This is also something that I got from Kuya Derek. It's that marriage is for a lifetime. And with that being said, I think I'm going to have to enjoy first just what Pastor Derek have said earlier. Before I commit myself or before I give myself in, since it is also said that marriage is more about giving more than taking.
Oh my God. My relationship.
Well, aww. Man, you are a wise man. Van,
you're more wiser.
We'll just put you at wait, because if you know that and you're living that out, it could happen any day.
Pastor, can you get my age? And that's my question.
You look still young.
How old?
Mm-hmm.
You're young but wise.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you, Pastor. Yeah.
So if you're really young, then wait patiently.
Yeah.
O lahat na magpapagess na ng age nito eh. Okay, we have Rochelle. Yes. Rochelle.
Can we have Rochelle later? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh yes.
Okay. I think I need translator po, sir.
Sige, ando naman si Sarah to translate.
Hello.
We can hear you.
Okay, for me po, what I got here is, do not just wait, but hope and trust with the Lord that He is preparing the right one for you.
Amen. Amen.
And allow the Lord to do all healing that's needed to prepare you properly. So wait patiently. Wait patiently.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Mga umaasa ng wait lang tong mga to eh. Okay, Reggie. Reggie from Dubai. Okay, Reggie.
Hello po, rinig po.
Yes.
Yes, go ahead.
For me is wait for the right person even though it's for a long time. Don't give in for the enemies of giving not the right person to you. Just wait for the right guidance of the Lord and have faith in Him.
Wow.
Excellent.
Amen. Thank you, Reggie.
Welcome po.
Tama.
Yes.
Nagsabi na si Pastor Derek kung wait daw.
Wait patiently po yata.
Wait patiently.
Okay.
Yeah.
Amen. Chama and Chris Mark. From Iligan. Wait, asama na. Oh, Roy. Anda pa si Roy. And Mana. Oh, Mana muna. Diyan na pala kayo eh.
Me. Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. I think this is so cool. Okay, listen. Are you ready?
Sit up, ready?
Okay. It's okay to send messages from the people who have wrong intentions in you. Cut it off.
Boom.
It's okay to scene zone those people. You know what? For you, Mana, you know, wait patiently, but it's going to be worth it. You are a wise woman. The crown.
Amen.
There's a double blessing for your life.
Yeah.
Just wait patiently.
Amen.
It will be worth it. And make sure he's mature enough to lead you and not just follow you.
Woo!
Yes.
It's prophetic.
Kung may mangligaw kay Mana, parents first.
May hear it.
They've got to go through the Father's house.
Yes.
We talk.
And casting and family.
Yes.
Okay, let's
hear it from the ate. Ate. Something. Ate. Sound. Yes. For me, there's a lot. But it's just one? Okay, I have to say this. So, there are things that are birthed only in waiting. Woo-hoo! So, I will wait.
Yeah. I'm just going to say this way.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Just wait.
Samson.
Just wait.
Go, lapit na.
So cute.
Just wait.
The Father has something to say.
Yeah, Father also wait.
Okay, wala na?
Okay.
So I think have... Alpha will
sila
read
Roy
some...
Ina, sila Roy.
Oh yeah, we still have Roy. And I think Alpha will also read those that have been posted on Facebook and YouTube.
Yes, po.
Okay, go.
Okay, for me po, leave the guilt and focus on what God can bring you or give you.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, definitely. Wait patiently, Roy. You got it.
Okay, amen. Okay. Yeah. See you. You have to meet your pastor, Roy. Okay, thank you, Pastor Derek, for that. Okay, Alpha and Micah. Are we reading those on YouTube and Facebook?
Yes,
okay, go ahead. Are they waiting also for the comment? If they will have to wait or just wait? Okay.
Let's make it very fast. For the answer.
Okay.
So Queens, from Queen says, this is my season of singleness and I refuse to awaken love because he and I are worth the wait.
Yeah, good. That's how you have to put the stand up, that I refuse. So great.
Yeah. Okay, another. Yeah.
He's the one who sent that is a student right now of history and I forgot her course.
Okay.
A student. Okay, what's the score?
Yeah. Wait. And just remember waiting. And refusing to awaken love doesn't mean just abstaining from sex. It's abstaining from emotional intimacy as well. So it's harder, you know, to abstain from that. I would say to you, wait patiently.
Queen says, take note. Okay, watching live. Okay, next.
Okay, last one from Ate Jessica. I will enjoy my season of waiting.
That's, with matching emphasis ng Ate Jessica talaga. Okay.
Okay. Ganda, Alpha. Pastor Derek said. Yes? Basahin mo ulit. Sabi niya pa. Sorry. I will enjoy my season of waiting.
Yeah, you know, I don't know if it's the same Jessica that I know.
Yes.
Yeah, you know, she is just a best kept secret in that church. You know, obviously I would say to her to wait and to really trust God and don't let anything hinder your self-confidence. Just put on confidence and people are attracted to that. And there should be no shame in your game. You know, just be who you are, and you know God has someone, but it's good that you didn't rush into something that wasn't good because God has best for you. I also feel you need to just continue to increase the prayers and pray that thing in. And you know, you are a gem, Jessica. You are a great catch, and so I'm glad you haven't rushed in just settling for somebody, because you deserve much better. So just wait.
Yes. Amen. Okay. So thank you everyone for sending your one-liner. And thank you that you have stayed with us. Thank you for everyone na nandito sa Zoom and even dun sa YouTube live natin. And to our amazing couple who waited patiently and trusted the Lord in the process. And thank you so much, Ate Sarah and Pastor Derek. Thank you very much. Again, congratulations for the precious gift God has given you. And the whole life of university is celebrating with you. Okay? So,
Well, you know, on behalf of myself and the baby, whatever it is, we want to say a big thank you to you, your leaders, this university, this Life Hub University is just awesome. You guys are awesome. You are special people. And Pastor M and Noems, we love you so much. And we're just honored that you invited us. So we'll see you again next time.
Yeah,
we'll see you more often. Do you want Pastor Derek and Sarah to be back?
Yes.
We'll talk about culture.
Yeah, in the morning when I wake up.
up. I just heard Pastor Derek saying, I'm excited to share about this with you tonight. You know?
Yeah, I was. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll watch out for our History Maker Society for the youth.
Tom, it's coming.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so please don't forget to like and share their Facebook. That's Derek Schneider and at History Maker Society. And also don't forget to subscribe and share their YouTube channel at Derek Schneider Official. Okay.
Yay.
Thank you.
Nice. Oh, by the way, we have a special greeting from Global Vision Mission or Mission Vision from Pastor Joshua Dong in USA. Oh, and yeah. I saw Pastor Derek's lined up also as a speaker there. And they are extending the invitation to all of us here at Life Hub. Pastor Joshua, we have been working with Pastor Joshua Dong, I think 20 years back then with the Youth for Christ. We used to have a TV ministry every Thursday and we do the dance portion like that. So we're just glad that God is reconnecting us once more.
That is amazing. I was so confused when I saw in the group chat, you guys were talking and I saw Pastor Derek and I thought, what is that? Am I sleeping? What is going on here? Small world, God ordained connection. So
yeah.
Thank you. Yay.
You don't know what I'm going to be speaking on yet that day, but watch out. It is going to be loaded for your nation, for your leaders. Do whatever you have to do to be on the broadcast that morning when I'm speaking.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
So for those who are interested to be interpreter, message us because they need still Ilocano, Bisaya, and Tagalog interpreters. Ayan. So, bye guys. Hello. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Ate Sam.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Ay, may sasabihin pa kayo.
Ate? Reggie po, Reggie.
Reggie. Red.
Yes. Kaya, yun. Yan naman mga hubmate. Samahan niyo ulit kami sa susunod na Biyernes para sa isa na namang exciting at makabuluhan na usapan. So be ready po. Every Friday po dito lamang sa Life Hub University. So huwag mag-skip dito sa class. Para maawan niyo na. So basta kung absent, no? Kahit absent pa siya kung sino man yung tinuturo ko dyan sa Zoom na katabi niyo. No? And huwag mali-late, please lang. Baka ma-delay din yung pagkikita nyo. So, stay updated!
Yeah, like and share po our official Facebook page at Life Hub University and Tribong Aguila Youth Production Network. Please also like po and subscribe our local artist channel on YouTube na nakasama natin dito sa university. Kaya join us, write more, and sing for Jesus! So, invite your friends at mag-alarm para di ma-late. Again, this is Micah.
This is Alpha.
And this is Tregi.
Ayan, kita-kita kits muli next Friday dito lang kung saan there is life and we value life dito lang sa
Life Hub University.
Bye! God bless po.
God bless po sa lahat.
God bless. Walang way.